I had no plans to make a video about this topic, but after the recent losses, the boring in football, the dependence on a certain player, and the possibility of a trophyless season, I decided to finally release a video, after I cancelled it in 2018. So in this video, we're gonna look at everything wrong with the current Barcelona, from the board, the players, the coach, the tactics, and the media. And of course, I will propose some solutions. So grab a snack, get comfy, and let's begin. The board. Here's a question. If you are given the choice between changing the board or sacking Valverde, you'll most likely choose the latter, which is changing Valverde with a more suitable coach. A decision that's more driven by feelings than logic. It's still a good decision though, but is it the best decision? Bartomeu, the board, or whoever is in charge of Barcelona has an agenda. These plans contradict with what Barcelona and its fans aspire the club to become. So what's wrong with the current board? The first one that comes to everyone's mind is Bartomeu. The president had his fair share of good and bad decisions. But I'd be lying to you if I told you that he's the guy who engineered all of this. He's only a mere successor. To whom? Say hello to Sandro Rosell, the first pillar and the architect behind Barca's depressing state. Understanding Sandro Rosell's motives is quite simple, and for that we need to compare him with Juan Laporta. I'll use a spectrum that goes from left to right. On the left side, we have growing your academy players, and on the right side, turning to the market and buying new players. For example, I'll take Florentino Perez. He's become synonymous with buying players and rarely, if never, counting on the academy. Even if a youngster is graduated to the first team, he'll most likely get offloaded to another club in the span of one or two seasons. So I'll put him on the far right. Laporta is in the middle. He believes in developing his own players, but he's rational. He knows he can't compete in the top level without filling the weak spots with new signings. And finally, our boy Rosell, just like Perez, is in the far right. Laporta is a Catalan nationalist. He's proud of his identity, and he shows that pride by caring about the tradition of developing La Masia. He has demonstrated it by appointing Johan Cruyff as his primary advisor. Johan was the one who told Laporta to hire both of Rijkaard and Pep Guardiola. Sandro Rosell is different. In his mind, the price boom of the transfer market in the early 2000s and the commercialization of football meant that he must totally ignore what Barcelona worked on since the 1980s and go with the trend of overspending money and globalizing Barcelona. The first thing he did as a president was sacking numerous academy managers and directors, and he replaced them with his own supporters. Even Johan Cruyff resigned after he heard the news that the club no longer wanted him. This is an old tactic that was used throughout history. When someone comes into power, he removes everyone that opposes him and replaces them with his own supporters, the ones who are on the same page as him. Rosell was very lucky. In his first two seasons, Barcelona won 7 trophies, largely due to Laporta. Rosell used this success to manipulate the media and ultimately the fans on thinking that the club's focus was still on developing the youth and preserving the club's identity. But he had other plans. In order for him to start commercializing Barcelona, he needed funds. So in 2011, he signed a deal with a new sponsor, Qatar Foundation. A 5-year deal of 150 million euros, replacing UNICEF. UNICEF wasn't really a sponsor. Barcelona was sending them a sum of $1.5 million in charity every year. Instead of the front, UNICEF's logo went to the bottom back. You should know that UNICEF was their first ever shirt sponsor, and Qatar Foundation was the first one that paid them money. Barcelona was super late on this. Just look at Real Madrid, who had won since the late 1980s. 2 freaking decades. Now Rosell has the money, and now he needs to spend it. The first thing that comes to my mind is Neymar's transfer. Do you know what was behind Neymar's transfer scandal? Well, tax evasion. 12 million euros of unpaid taxes. This event attracted unwanted attention from the largest football association, FIFA, who made some investigations and found out that Barcelona did not respect the rules of transfers regarding foreign underage players. Rosell was never an honest man. In 2008, he founded a marketing firm called Elanto and signed a deal with the Brazilian Football Federation, and was later accused by the authorities of padding and corruption. First of all, he removes experienced academy staff and he replaces it with inexperienced ones. And then he puts Barcelona on a different track. This sudden shift of priorities divided the club, which prompted the departure of Guardiola, who was not supported by Russell.
Ladies and gentlemen, we got him.
Russell goes to jail and in his chapter. His vice president Bartomeu becomes the successor, the new president of Barcelona. Because they've been exposed, the rat cannot go the same route as Russell. But unfortunately, not much has changed. That's why I told you that sacking Valverde won't help Barca's current situation, when the board's focus stays practically the same. Before I discuss tactics and before I judge Valverde, I must talk with you about the use of the media by Barcelona in order to censor and manipulate its fans. First of all, you should know that Barcelona, the club, and the media outlets like Sport, Mundo Deportivo, Radio Catalunya, and others are like partners. Barca persuades them to write articles or talk about certain subjects they want, even censoring a few topics in exchange for some exclusive club info. This happens everywhere, in football, politics, entertainment, etc. We see this manipulation in full effect during the transfer market. When Barcelona wants to buy a player, they use Messi. And you see headlines such as, Barcelona are close to buying X player and Messi is supportive of this action. Or something like this, Messi is suggesting this player. Or along the lines of, there are rumors circulating around X player after recent Messi praise. Heck, someday they'll release rumors about Shrek and they'll say Messi likes his devastating farts. Leo is the club's talisman, the best player in the world, and fans have him in such high regard. So when the newspaper tells you that Messi wants this player in the club, the unexperienced fan agrees. If Messi says so, the club must hurry and buy the player. This had a negative effect on how people view Messi, because the rival media outlets, mostly the ones in Madrid, twisted Barca's exploitation of Messi to their own version. And that's where rumors about Messi being a dictator and a second coach selecting players and crushing others in both Barcelona and Argentina emerged from. And Barcelona are indirectly behind this mess. During sudden disqualifications from the Champions League, you know, Roma, Liverpool, yeah, those disaster classes, fans were furious about the results. Therefore, they reacted on social media. And of course, the whole blame was on the coach. Valverde out, Valverde out. This hashtag trended on Twitter for I don't know how many times. Guess what was Barca's response? Firstly, they defended their coach. He's the right coach, he's the right person for Barcelona, blah 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 blah. But the second part of their response was insulting to fans. They said that the ones behind this whole movement against the coach were French bots. French bots. They want us to think that some people are so desperate that they created fake accounts that auto-generate comments and tweets. And of all places, they chose France. Well, maybe PSG wants to take revenge. This incident reminded me of another one. During Russell's presidency, yeah, I know, this guy again. In 2010, as soon as he got elected, he changed the requirements of becoming a club member. Now, you need to have connections with the club, maybe a family member, and most importantly, be Catalan to be eligible for a membership. But what about outsiders? Don't worry, there's another membership for foreigners. But you can't vote in elections, and you do not benefit from ticket price reductions. The majority of Barca fans are foreigners. The club can't easily control the thoughts of these foreigners, the same as the Catalan members, who can vote. Because these members are heavily influenced by the media every day, their votes will benefit the current board. So in the future, don't believe everything that those media outlets spit in their newspapers. Of course, Barcelona are not behind everything that is said by the media. Most of what gets published are lies that solely exist to drive sales or increase traffic to their websites. That's why they have their own social media accounts and of course, their TV channel called Barça TV. Now, I'll close this page to open another and talk about Valverde, La Masia, the players and tactics. First of all, Valverde is not suited for Barcelona. He has no experience coaching a big club, and the current board wants Valverde to stay because he's unproblematic. He is what we call a yes man. He's not a big name in the business. He's like the board's puppet. Of course, he chooses his own lineups, but he never intervenes with the board's decisions. The most obvious example is transfers. The board has full control. They bought Paulinho, Arthur de Jong, but he had nothing substantial to say, and he always agrees with their decisions. They're simply keeping him because he does not interfere. Let's take a look at Valverde's tactics during the last 2 years. In 2018, fans criticized his use of a 4-4-2 formation instead of the usual 4-3-3. They pointed out its flaws: too rigid, defensive-minded, the absence of wingers that stretch the opponent's defenses and help with the passing lanes, he did not give enough resting times for his players, the latter felt fatigue which resulted in wasted games like Roma. After that game, it was apparent that Barca needed fresh blood, I mean new players to reinforce the squad after the horrible signings of 2017. We also learned that Barcelona was too dependent on Messi, especially when Messi missed the only game in the league, which resulted in a loss just because the board wanted him rested for a friendly game. We also witnessed the regression of both Suarez and Rakitic. However, after the loss against Liverpool, some of what I mentioned earlier was not entirely correct. For example, player fatigue. It was not the problem. In 2019, Barca players were rested before the game, and they played less games throughout the year compared to 2018. But still, they lost. And this loss also showed to us fans that we were right about certain elements. Rakitic, Suarez, and of course Valverde. In order to explain what's wrong with Valverde's approach to games, I'll take a look at the Liverpool away match because it was memorable, and one of the few that encapsulate Barca's problems in 90 minutes straight. Valverde's first mistake was looking at the away game with the same lens he did with the home game. He used the same starting lineups, with the midfield of Coutinho, Rakitic, Busquets, and Vidal. It worked at home because of individual brilliance, but then they failed at Anfield. Why? His mistake was him failing to understand that Barcelona has a problem scoring goals away from home. In the last two Champions Leagues, Barca only scored 10 goals in away games compared to 33 goals at home, for two reasons. Their striker, Luis Suarez, hasn't scored an away goal in the Champions League since September 2015, and also because Barca attempts two times less shots in away games. The data specialists confirmed that shot supremacy is more important than ball possession for winning football games. On average, if you shoot more than your opponent, you're more likely to win. And of course, when you have the home advantage, you tend to shoot more. Valverde was trying to maintain the lead, but he used the wrong players. One player could have prevented this loss: Arthur Melo. Barcelona bought the Brazilian for many reasons. His ball retention is great. Opponents can hardly remove the ball from him. And like Rakitic, Arthur is press resistant. One of Barca's biggest issues was the lack of creativity. Do you know why? As I said a few seconds ago, Rakitic is not press resistant, which means that when he just receives a pass and opponents quickly get close to him, and because he doesn't have that calmness, that composure, he loses concentration and control over the situation, and he ends up passing the ball back or sideways. And in a lot of cases, Barca loses on great occasions, just because one of their players can't create. But Arthur is not of the same breed. When Rakitic passes the ball back, in his mind he says, "At least I did not lose the ball. Even though I passed it back to Piqué, we still have possession. You know, I'm something of a footballer myself." Yeah, you're gonna keep possession, but you're gonna make it harder for your teammates to keep that possession for longer. You'll pass to Piqué, the opponents will press on him, this will make it harder for him to concentrate, so he'll either clear it or he'll pass it back to Ter Stegen, and the goalie will eventually clear it. The opponent gets the ball and we are back to square one. So first, you mess up a good counterattack, secondly, you waste time, thirdly, you might cause a goal against your team because they did not have enough time to think of a solution, four, you lose the ball, and lastly, you waste more time and energy trying to retrieve the ball. Now let's go back to Liverpool. Valverde, Ernesto, you did not understand the most basic things about Liverpool. The Reds are a team who rely on counterattacks, speed, and fast transitions. Instead of creative midfielders, they have workhorses. This is basic stuff. Everyone knows this. The best way to counter these systems is to have players who are press resistant, who can keep possession for longer periods of time, for 2-3-4 minutes straight. And you might exhaust Liverpool's stamina. Some of you might be skeptical at what I'm saying, at what I'm conveying right now. Don't worry, I'll give an example. I guess most of you know how Barca used possession-based football to dominate football between 2008 and 2012. When a team is playing against Barcelona, let's say in 2011 for example, do you know what happens to them after 60 minutes? Well, they usually get exhausted. Exhausted from running right and left for minute after minute after minute Because those nerds, yeah, those nerds with red and blue shirts are 100 passes in, they've been passing for 3 minutes straight, they had possession for 80% of the time, and they're not stopping anytime soon. The most underrated aspect and a direct consequence of playing tiki-taka is that your opponents are gonna get tired from continuous running. Liverpool feast on counters and on silly mistakes. Don't give them the opportunity and use your best midfielders. I'm not gonna lie. Exactly after 15 minutes, I felt that Barcelona needed Arthur to be subbed in as quickly as possible to control the game, to slow the tempo down a bit. Intensity. What frustrates me the most about Barca's approach, you know, the way they handle games, instead of keeping a steady pace during the whole match, they start off slow. Real slow. I'm not the only one who thinks this way. Valverde's team needs 15, 20, 30, sometimes a whole full half to heat up their gears and get a hold on the game. That's one of the reasons they score more goals in second halves. In 2019 alone, they scored 59 in second halves and 42 in first halves. And sometimes it's the opposite. In first halves they play great, and second halves they, I don't know. And in second halves they, you know, they sleep. Valverde is incapable of giving psychological support to his players. When Liverpool scored the first one, I'm pretty sure that the players experienced Roma flashbacks. Even we as spectators thought of a possible remontada. If only they had someone with guts, with character, who'd make them forget about the past failures and encourage them to focus on the present. Unfortunately, Ernesto is not the type to do so. Suarez and Coutinho. I guess most of you already know my stance on Luisito. He's both a defensive and an attacking liability. During the defensive phase, Barcelona cannot press effectively. Firstly, Coutinho was misused on the left flank. He's naturally an attacking midfielder. He doesn't have the speed or the experience to play as a winger. Plus, his defensive contribution was horrendous. Since 2017, Barca are using a 4-4-2 formation in defense. The problem is not the formation, but the players. Especially Messi and Luis Suarez. Both of them rarely press or contribute to retrieve the ball from opponents. I can forgive Messi for not doing so, because he balances it with his immense attacking contribution. But you can't have two players doing so. Suarez is inactive. He doesn't run nor press, and the opposing defenders have a walk in the park. This puts Barca's midfielders in a dilemma. Should they move up front and press, and in return they expose the space behind them, or they stay in their positions, and of course they make it easier for the opposing defenders. And it's the same problem during counterattacks. The faster they transition from defense to attack, the more likely a team is going to score. But because of Suarez, they miss out on a lot of good scoring opportunities. So, what's the fix? Well, you already know, seriously. A front three of Messi, Griezmann and Dembele. I hope it happens, you know. But the problem is not entirely Valverde. It's also Dembele's problem. Ernesto keeps on insisting with Suarez because he's not injury prone. So he goes for the easiest choice, Messi, Suarez and Griezmann. Griezmann is a great signing, and he must become our first choice striker. He played for Atletico Madrid, one of the most physically demanding teams in the world. Antoine has the assets to replace and do a better job than Suarez right now. Better stamina means he can press more effectively, he's fast on counters, and he plays associative football. He does everything Barca needs, but when you use him on the wing, you are basically telling him that you're not important. Suarez must be benched and used as a second striker. Preserving La Masia is essential to Barca's success in the long run, especially financially. What's great about being a club with a reliable academy is that you are able to teach kids your football philosophy early on, which saves you time. You teach them in their youth, then they're promoted to the first team, already knowing how to play the way you intend them to, giving you, as a club, an advantage compared to other clubs. And to top it off, you sign a coach who believes in that philosophy. And then you just fill in the blanks by buying the players you need. Relying solely on transfers is a bad idea. Barcelona has Messi. They can screw up a few times and still win trophies. However, when you lose your stars, then you experience seasons of droughts, you know, 3, 5, 6 years of trophyless seasons, and on top of that, you don't have a reliable academy, well, you either get the Arsenal treatment or the Man United one. And God forbid, the AC Milan treatment. No trophies for long periods of time equals not much money equals to not being capable of affording big stars, equals more unsuccessful years, and the cycle repeats. Or, you have the money, but you are not spending it well, so you end up less successful than you used to, and now, buying new players is a hassle. They're gonna demand higher wages, because that's the only attractive thing you can offer them. But if a successful club demands the services of a football star, they are more likely to accept less money if it meant being successful and winning more trophies. I think I'll end the video right here. Barcelona are a club like many others that are run by businessmen rather than passionate footballers. The likes of Xavi and Puyol do not want to be associated with the current world, and they're waiting until the results of the 2021 elections to reintegrate Barcelona. There's much more to be said, but it was going to be too long, so I tried to condense as much as I could. I did not release a video for more than a month. The reason is that I have studies, I don't have as much free time, plus I was demonetized, so it rendered me sad and shocked for a couple weeks, and also because of procrastination. But now, I'll try returning to my previous pace of one video per week. I do have another video that's halfway through in the making, and hopefully it'll be uploaded in the next week. Again, thanks for watching, write down your opinions and your observations about the topic, and let's have a fruitful conversation in the comments section.